central Florida, just above the Everglades and northwest. Big Lake Okeechobee, this is Far Out Radio. I'm Scott Teeters. Today is Monday. It is March the 14th, 2016. Hope you had a good day and a nice weekend. Private investigator Leanne Jones is back with us this evening. With over 30 years of field experience, Leanne has a unique experiential understanding of the dark side of our society. You know, when someone hires a private eye, it's usually because something's going on and it's not good. Of course, the work of a private investigator isn't anywhere near as exciting as what we see on TV detective shows, and the business has changed tremendously since Leanne began. But when you're immersed in this kind of work, it's an on-the-job education about the dark side of human thinking and behavior. Of course, aberrant behavior has always been a part of the human experience. For decades, Hollywood has entertained us with films where the central character is a psychopath. The 1957 film, A Face in the Crowd with Andy Griffith, is outstanding. If you watch it, you will come away with a whole new respect for Andy Griffith as an actor. Then there was the 1960 Alfred Hitchcock film, Psycho, starring Anthony Perkins and Janet Leigh, that kept a lot of people out of the shower for a very long time. But the film that brought psychopathy into mainstream conversation was Jonathan Demme's 1991 thriller, Silence of the Lambs. This is an outstanding film, but for me, I did not like it. I very much prefer not to get into the mind of, you know, Hannibal Lecter types, thank you. But as a result of this film, more and more people have been studying psychopathy, which is a very good thing. Because the more we know about the dark side, the better able we are to avoid these kinds of people. Of course, the final sentence in understanding psychopaths is to not engage them and avoid them as much as possible, because you cannot change them, you cannot fix them, and if you take them on, things will most likely go very badly. Leanne Jones has contributed to the body of research on psychopathy. She's written a booklet for her clients titled Psychoanalysis, a Psychopath Awareness Handbook. And you know what happens to people who start writing books? They keep writing more books. Leanne has written a new book, and it is titled Blood in the Cabin, Real Events and a Revelation, A Private Investigator's Files. Leanne lays out the facts, photos, interviews, and documents in two British Columbia cold cases. So if you have a passion for mystery and intrigue, Blood in the Cabin is available at Amazon.com in print and in Kindle format. Leanne's been with us many times before, and you can access her previous visits by going to faroutradio.com and look for our bright graphic that says Far Out Radio on YouTube. Click through, then look for the playlist tab. Click and look for Leanne Jones. Listen, enjoy, and learn. And if you're interested in some private eye services, her website is detective-international.com. Leanne is also the author of the delightful book, It's Cool to Be Clever, the story of Edson C. Hendricks, the genius who invented the design of the Internet. The book's available at Amazon.com in print and in Kindle format. It's a very, very sweet and inspiring book, and Edson has been a guest on Far Out Radio many times. Leanne, welcome back to the program.
Well, thank you, Scott. It's very nice to be back on Far Out Radio.
Gosh, you are like completely in the opposite corner of the continent from where we are, and you sound like you're in the other room. Good to hear from you.
Well, I was wondering if it would sound very good or not, because I only have one telephone now. It's the cellular telephone, so I have to be careful how far I get away from it.
Well, okay, good. Honey West, chill us out a little bit there. Oh, okay, let me interject this here. For our younger listeners, I'm not being a flirt. Honey West was a lady private eye show starring the lovely and talented Anne Francis in 1965 and 66. Of course, back then I was mostly watching I Dream of Jeannie and the Beverly Hillbillies. Couldn't keep my eyes off Ellie Mae Clampett, but I did see a few episodes of Honey West, and oh, if it was only that glamorous, right?
Right. There's a lot of waiting around, and you do have to wait if you're going to find the good stuff.
I suppose, you know, it's one of those things, Leanne, most of us just don't really think a whole lot about, but the waiting, for modern people, we tend to be rather impatient. You know, we want things very quickly, and so, you know, you obviously are a very, very patient person.
I'm, it's a it's something you learn as well, because I know if I have to wait at a doctor's office or I have to wait at the hairdresser's, I can wait for a long time and be completely content, just observing things around. Sometimes when I was working on a case, if there was a long waiting period, I sometimes wrote poetry. But you have to be careful, because just as sure as shooting, you might be writing at the wrong time. You have to be watching and writing at the same time.
Yeah, just the moment you start looking up in the sky for that rhyming word, you know.
Exactly.
The person of interest, comes out of the motel room.
You have to be ready.
Now, the two cases that are in your book happened very early on in your career, yet in the foreword of your book, you write that they still haunt you. So tell us about the cases and why, after all these years, do they still bother you?
Well, it's interesting. I had actually forgotten about both of them for a long while, and then one morning, I guess a few months ago, or maybe 6 months ago, I had a dream, and I dreamt about the cases. So I went looking for my file box, and it was like an archaeological dig to find the thing. It took me all day, and finally I found the box. It had everything in it. It had the pictures, the clippings from the newspaper, all of my notes, which I always had the habit of making a brochure about my cases, so that I wrote up the story as it happened. So that was good, because then the dates were accurate, and I didn't have to do too much searching on the computer. And so the two cases were very haunting, because there were several psychopaths in those two cases. The way I think of the psychopath is that in this particular case of Cindy James, I think of maybe a cat who toys with the mouse, enjoying the sight of the mouse running around in terror, you know, trying to escape, because the ultimate joy for the cat is the prolonged terror of the mouse. And in that, in Cindy's case, she was actually harassed for 7 years, and she had recorded more than 100 incidents of absolute terror.
What kind of harassment, Leanne?
Well, she was often phoned with seriously threatening phone calls. She had 3 attempts on her life. She was assaulted. She was raped. She was often tied tightly, almost in a choking manner, with a black nylon. And she was dumped at the University of British Columbia on the site of the university. And that was when she was taken to the head of the forensic department there. And I do have an interview in there with him. And she did eventually go to the hospital there, and she, where they did a rape kit. And suddenly the lead detective decided he'd better get a hold of that rape kit. And when he got there to get it, it had mysteriously disappeared. There was a lot of mystery in the two cases. And
Leanne, with that many varied assaults, had she not contacted the police? And if so...
Oh, yeah. Yeah, no, the police were contacted many times. In fact, every time, practically. And, of course, what happened was they thought that she was doing it for attention. But eventually it came out that she hired a lead detective with Ozzy Caban, and he had the idea of getting a hold of a hypnotist, a really well-renowned hypnotist, Cal Booker. And... so he hypnotized her. I think there were 3 sets, and on the 3rd one, what came out was a horrific tale of something that she witnessed that really put her into a state of, you know, where they have that PTSD, right, like they do after coming back from a war. And then after that, she left. She said it happened when she was on a voyage with her ex-husband. So she left her husband, and then after that, the harassment started. So she sort of thought it was her ex-husband, but it may have been others as well. So the whole story is, in my book, is my notes, my photographs, different clippings, and then I sort of leave it up to the reader to, I guess the challenge for the readers to figure out how the pieces fit together.
You mentioned Hal Booker, the hypnotist.
Yes.
In your line of work, how reliable do you find that tool?
Well, you do have to have a very a good one. His credentials were very good, and I actually heard the tapes as they were played during the inquest. It was probably the longest inquest in the history of BC before the pig farmer inquest, which was a few years back. But the tapes were absolutely chilling, and you knew they were authentic. And so in my book, I have written out like the audio part of the tape so that the person reading the story can think about them and see how they fit with the rest of the information that I found.
Right.
And it was during that, after the hypnosis tape, that I had a revelation that possibly the victim, there was a double murder in a cabin, and I had the revelation that I thought the victim was another nurse from my case up in the Seashell area, because the description seemed to match her. And so that was, I tried to put that out into the press, but I didn't realize the protocol for the inquest at the time. You had to have everything had to be put in ahead. And so later, I found out more. I went back to Seashell and went on to the island, or an island, not the island. And then I did a lot more investigation as to whether that was the right island. And then I had to look at a few other islands. And then I heard a story. And the story was about a cabin where people that were the locals, they said that there had been a couple living in that cabin, and they suddenly disappeared. And when people went into the cabin, there was blood everywhere. Mm. And so didn't think anything of it, because the couple never made an effort to get to know them or anything. So they just sort of forgot about it. And this was a
really?
Story I heard later. Yes. So this
was,
is where,
was the blood ever checked to find out, is this animal blood? Were they dressing deer in there, or was it human blood?
Well, the locals thought it was an animal kill, but no one ever thought to have it DNA done. It was
really
before the DNA time. Mm-hmm. And then since that story, I went searching for that cabin, and I found that there had been a cabin, but it had been removed. So there again, it was impossible to find out for sure. You know.
So all you're left with then is a story. In your book, you refer to it as the legend of the bloody cabin. You know, it's got all the earmarks of a campfire story, but.
Well, the thing is, also since then, even since my book has come out, I've had a few tips, and that's what's been very interesting, because the tips have come from people who read the book, and this is why I'm hoping that, I guess that's the ultimate hope, that someone will know something and they will come forward with it.
It would be neat if you could get some of the gist of your book serialized in the local newspapers, you know, for people to read. And who knows? You know, there might be somebody in their 60s or 70s who was a young person back then who, you know, might have heard something. You know,
I'll tell you what's happening. Something very interesting happening. It's being developed. like they're developing the book, and I'm working with a producer-director, Michael Robison, as a limited or a sort of an anthology television series.
Oh, how cool.
So it's interesting.
So when this comes on television, underneath, after the name of it, Blood in the Cabin, it'll say, based upon Leanne Jones' book, Blood in the Cabin. Cool.
Inferno.
Those kinds of things really do happen. We've been enjoying a television program that's been on for about six or 7 years. We're watching it through Amazon, so we're watching every episode one after the other. But it's called Justified, and was based off of a short story somebody wrote about a U.S. Marshal in Kentucky. Very cool story, but those things happen.
Now, people are watching Netflix, and they're sort of binge-watching the whole television series at a time.
It's
and,
fun. I
it
must
is
confess.
Fun.
Best
right
part,
now,
you don't have the best part, Leanne, is that you don't have to suffer through the drug commercials.
That's exactly what it is.
Now, I'm curious, Leanne, when you went back to your files and... You basically were looking at it from two unique perspectives. One was with fresh eyes, and the other one was with a lot more experience. So when you went back over all your material, did anything jump out at you? Did you connect any dots that perhaps hadn't occurred to you previously?
Well, I went madly looking for an old video I had of the island. The reason I thought the case might be... joined, not only because the description of the victim in the Cindy James case matched the victim up in the seashell area, but at that time, Cindy tells about the voyage that she had with her ex-husband to look at a piece of property, and the property was on an island, and Julia, the girl that was in the other case, had an island. So that's where I thought that must be the island. So I went back to the seashell area and I took a video of the cabin on the island. And after looking at it, I didn't really think that was the right cabin. It didn't match all the detail in the tale as told by Cindy under hypnosis. So I looked and looked for that video. And finally, I found it, and it was unbelievably scratchy, jumpy. It was a voyage with one of the ladies. She was a native lady. She was a warpinger. She's the lady that kept the all the data on the different boats and things that came and went. And she took me right out to the island, and so I took... I finally found that video, and I took it into a studio where they were able to capture stills. And so I have stills of the cabin in my book. And I was so pleased to have found that video. I was thinking I only wish that I had thought more about it way back then. But as you say, you do get... with experience, you have a little bit more perspective, you know?
Mm-hmm. Now, both of these gals were nurses. Do you think it was a coincidence, yeah, or is it with someone who had a nurse obsession?
Well, interesting thing I found out was that the ex-husband, who was a doctor, and he was actually a psychologist, and he had actually also tried the exams to become a psychiatrist. And he did work with one of the psychiatrists up at the university. And the thing was that he also visited the clinic up in Seashell area where the other girl, the other nurse, was now a part-time reporter. She had been a nurse, but when she became married, she got a little part-time job as a reporter, and she was looking in on a case of fired nurses, and it was in the clinic where the doctor from the other case often went. And later, I heard a lot of hearsay things, you know, those you will have to look at in the book, and some of them... They're probably just, you know, rumors and things, so you have to take everything with a grain of salt. But there could have been that connection. Could have been to do with drugs and nurses, you know.
Yeah, everybody's got a theory, you know, and people like to talk, that's for sure. When you were up there looking around and asking questions, what kind of response did you get?
Oh, people were very open. They all thought, of course, they always think that the husband is. In any case, where there's a murder of the wife, there's usually they take a good hard look at the husband. But they had other suspects as well on both cases. And the characters that I talked to up in the Seashell area were really interesting. They were weird and wonderful characters. One was a gypsy, and I still can't believe that I was going up and driving to these places with people that I didn't know about and having interviews and never even worried about it. But this one fellow who was a gypsy, very interesting fellow, he had looked like a lighter, but he said he got it in during the war when he was a gopher, and like that's a person who goes behind the enemy lines, and he took this thing from a Nazi officer that's been killed, and he told me that it was a special gadget that they communicated with each other on, and on the top of the gadget, which looked like a lighter, was the formula for cold fusion.
Wow, so, that's a bit of a stretch. Okie dokie. Leanne, we've got our music playing in the background, so we're going to take our one and only commercial break. If you're just joining us, Leanne Jones, a private investigator, is with us, and we're talking about her new book, Blood in the Cabin. And you can get more information about Leanne, hire her if you need a private eye. Go to her website, detective-international.com. We'll be right back. Welcome back to Far Out Radio. On a Monday night, Leanne Jones is with us. She's a private investigator, a lady private eye. How about that? With about 30-plus years of experience, and she's telling us about her new book, Blood in the Cabin. Leanne, I was reading through some of your material, and now these two gals, their murders are 10 years apart, Julia Klachan and Cindy James, 10 years apart.
No, not really. They're only 2 years apart. Julia went missing in 79, and the voyage where the double murder took place was in 81. But Cindy, yes, you were right. Cindy wasn't murdered. Well, I feel that she was murdered until that period of time. But the voyage where she describes the double murder, which could have involved the other girl, it would have been almost 2 years apart. And the other girl could have been living with a boyfriend. It's a possibility, but nothing has ever been proven, you know.
Now, Julia's the one that had been stalked and raped and...
No, Cindy.
Cindy, okay.
Her name was Cindy Makepeace, but she changed her name after she witnessed that double murder, according to her hypnosis tape. She tells it under hypnosis because she had buried it. She had blocked it. So they, in order to help her, they tried to regress her, and they were successful until she was able to recall what it was that was actually causing her this PTSD. And at the time, it was a strange time because it was a time when police also were thinking that women were histrionic and maybe doing things to themselves to get attention. Not all police, but some. And some psychiatrists had the idea that these women were histrionic and so on. But I looked in, I did some research on psychiatry at the time, and two out of the three psychiatrists that were mentioned in her case had studied under at the Allen Memorial in Montreal, where the teachings of Ewan Cameron were still in effect. And Ewan Cameron had been hired one time by the CIA. He did the MK Ultra teaching, which was to groom an agent to be an anti-Manchurian candidate, right, so that they could, you know, all of that stuff. Well, when they used that teaching in the usual institutions across Canada, they were able to, well, their whole idea was that there were four types of people in the society that were weak, and that it was the duty of the psychiatrist to discipline these people. And there were four types. One was the passive person who had no opinion. The other was a possessive type person. Another one was an insecure person, which would have been Cindy. And the most dangerous of all, the psychopath. So a lot of the psychiatrists at the time, they were, you can see where if somebody was, had the wrong, if that type of teaching got into the wrong hands, they could actually manipulate people.
And well, so I think it's already in the wrong hands. I don't trust these MK Ultra types at all. It's already in the wrong hands.
So there
could
was
you repeat
some of that.
Those personality types, because yeah, I don't, I've never heard anybody elucidate it quite that way. I mean, there's a lot of talk about psychopaths, but what were the other personality types?
Okay, number one, a passive person who has no opinion, and number two, a possessive type person, and number three, an insecure person, and most dangerous of all, the psychopath.
Right.
Because psychopath, if you give a psychopath is a killer. If you give them an opportunity for that, they're going to take it. And so if there was, supposing there was someone like a psychiatrist or someone that was sociopathic as well, and they wanted something done, it's a possibility that they could use that type of person. And I find nowadays the policing and the psychiatry is quite a bit different. With I had a tip come in from someone who read my, and it was a tip to a possible suspect. So I phoned the cold case file, and I was speaking to a Constable Nash in the Richmond department there, and he was as happy as a lark to receive all the information. And I thought, my goodness, I couldn't get over the change. And I asked him if he'd like a copy of my book. Yes, he'd like a copy. So I find that there's quite a bit of a difference than the way back there when I really found that the women had a hard time, you know, telling their stories.
Well, that's good to hear. We're making progress, I suppose.
Yeah, I think so.
Now, Julia, in your book, you write that Julia was last seen leaving to go to South Africa. Apparently, her ex-husband died in the plane crash, and she was going to go off and find herself. I remember that back then. It was like a meme that went out into the culture. I don't know if it came from self-help books or what, but, you know, I have to go find myself. Okay, well, look in the mirror. Did she show up? Did anybody look for her in South Africa?
Oh, yes. They phoned the relatives in South Africa, and she never arrived. And so, of course, the suspicion was on her husband. And that's all of the interviews I did with people that were around them at the time and some of the things they said. And you're right, they were all into that self-help thing and they were reading a book called Seth the Remembers or something, and there was all kinds of weird stuff going on up there. And so she was never seen again, but her ex-husband, or I mean her husband, her second husband, said that she told him she had to go off to see if she could find herself, and all he heard was that when she left that morning was the slam of a car door. That was according to him.
So, was there any life insurance policy? Were there any life insurance policies cashed in?
I don't know about that, but it was a fantastic house that he built for her. It was called the Castle. And it was something I've never seen in my life before. On the living room wall, that was painted over by the time I got there, but he had painted the whole Battle of Agincourt, stallions and all.
Really?
And he was a wonderful artist, and he had built many houses up in that area. One house was where the pool table lowered itself into the, you pushed a button and it lowered down, and then when you wanted it again, you pushed the button and up it would come. And and his father told
too.
Well, his father, his interview in the book is really quite interesting.
Now, you also mentioned here that the police did not investigate this thoroughly. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, they tried to. It just said that every time they went, nothing seemed to happen. But there was one wonderful police investigator. His name was Boyer Smythe, and he definitely knew that there was something happening. At first, he didn't think so, and then he later was convinced. And when it came to the inquest time, they asked him who he thought was the perpetrator, and he pointed directly to her ex-husband.
The one in South Africa?
Yes. And in one of the assaults, she heard Zulu words spoken, and apparently they were words that he often spoke. And
Zulu?
Yeah, they were Zulu words, and it meant, "Go carefully, my son."
Oh, yeah. So, all people in British Columbia talk that way all the time, right?
Yeah.
No. Okay.
So
were there any records of him being in British Columbia prior to her disappearance?
Well, he'd been there. He'd come from South Africa. This is Cindy Jane's husband. He had been there for quite a while, and they were married. He had been married before in South Africa, and then he came to Canada, and he married Cindy James. I was just trying to think when it was that he married her, but she was 44. She was 44 years old, and Julia was 31. So you have to read the book.
Yeah. Now, you mentioned that unlike Julia, Cindy's body was found not long after she went missing. She was found hog-tied and drugged, and the police said it was a suicide.
Yes. Well, apparently the police were getting their information from this Dr. Marcus that was head of the UBC forensic department. And I had an interview with him, so that's a very interesting interview in the book. And he did say, when I interviewed him, he said that if he thought that it was going to turn out like that, he would have done more. But it's a strange group of characters. One policeman was sent to stay outside of Cindy's house, and he instead got into an affair with her. So there were all kinds of things that happened with that whole case. It was just bizarre from beginning to finish, and it's still going on.
I've seen that in a few movies, actually. The Bodyguard, one of them comes to mind.
Yeah.
Kevin Costner and Whitney Houston, back when she was absolutely stunningly beautiful.
Yeah, I remember that. I like that one.
So the case is still open. I couldn't get past this business of finding somebody who's been drugged and hog-tied and gone, yep, looks like a suicide to me. You know?
I know.
It's absolutely absurd.
Well, the doctor at the university, the psychiatrist, he said, well, I think it was only one hand to one ankle. And I asked the parents of Cindy if that was true, and they said, oh, absolutely not. She was both hands tied to her ankles at the back.
Oh,
and
she
was heavily, heavily drugged with morphine and other drugs. And of course, it was a whole week, so it was not a very pretty sight, you know.
Yeah, yeah. All the details aside, as I was going through everything, I was curious. I wanted to ask you, this is just, you know, a private investigator kind of a thing. How do you start something like this? Somebody gets in touch with you and say, we want you to, you know, do a private investigation. Where do you begin on things like this?
Well, with the first one was Julia and her mom and dad. Well, I've done, I haven't counted the number of cases. I've worked on 10, maybe 12 murder cases with really strange things that happen in them. So I'm thinking of writing them into an anthology now. But
might as well.
At that time, I was hired by the parents of Julia, and she had gone missing, so they had, a police detective had been working on it for quite a while, nearly 7 years. No, not that long, pardon me, maybe 7 months. And so they wondered what was going on up there because they couldn't go up that often and they didn't seem to be able to get information. So they sent me up there to look around on it. And so that's how it began. I just started doing interviews with the people I heard about. And that's in the beginning part of my book. And then with the other one, I had an extreme interest because it was only 3 blocks away from my mother, and it was a second nurse, and I had so much access to it that I met the parents, and then the mother hired me. So here I was hired by both mothers on both cases, which was also very interesting because they lived where I lived in Sydney. And so I had complete access to them. And then when I went over to the mainland, I had complete access because my mother lived very close to the scene. So I had the feeling that this was meant to be, that I see these things. I've always felt that, you know.
Right. Now, when you were going back into, some people would say, you know, tearing off an old scab, did anybody that you wanted to talk to say, absolutely not, get out of here?
For one thing, both sets of parents are deceased. The both perpetrators are deceased. And so I really haven't had anyone. When I was doing some research on the realty up in the Seashell area just to see if the island had been owned by both Paul and both Julia, because the parents kept saying it was Julia's island. And so I did do some research, and the one realtor was very helpful. I actually haven't met any. Oh, there was one lady that said I could use the information she gave me, but not her name. That was, and another one that gave me the story of the blood in the cabin, it was the same. I could use the story, but not her name.
No. Okay. Some people don't want attention. That's understandable.
It's probably smart.
Yeah. Now, when you went back up there and you started talking to people, were the police cooperative?
The police up there were very cooperative, and in fact, one fellow told me, I went to the police station, and there was a little rookie constable on there, and he actually opened the file and let me not see it, but he had it there, and I could read upside down. But later, the staff sergeant came out, and he said, you know, There's a proper protocol. When you're going into an area, you should contact the staff sergeant. And so I thought, you know, that's really good. And I tucked that away. I thought, I'll remember that. But actually, as I was walking away, I thought, but I did learn quite a lot from the rookie. Mm-hmm. But it is proper to, because he said that then they can keep an eye out for you, and they can also help if anything goes wrong, you know. So I thought it was good advice.
Well, that's good. As you were describing your story of, you know, the woods and these very remote places, what came to mind was, it's a fellow named Dave Pallades who wrote a book titled Missing 411, and it's about missing people from national parks. And his experience of dealing with the park rangers is not good. And this is a man who's a former policeman.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah.
Well, there are a lot of missing people. It's difficult to get help on those. I don't know why it's that way, but seems to be that way.
Well, David has said many times on programs, and he writes about it in his book, that he absolutely, every time he tries to speak with park rangers, it's like running headlong into a brick wall. They absolutely refuse to assist. And, you know, it happened enough times where it's pattern, and you got to wonder, you know, why? Well, at least you got cooperation.
Yes. I did, even actually on the Cindy James case, the one constable who was head of the, directly ahead of that case, came to visit me when I was at my mother's, and he wanted to hear what I had found, mm-hmm. which I thought was very interesting, and he was very nice. But when it came to the inquest, I had to be a little more careful, you know. Right. I didn't really know the protocol of the inquest, but now I do, you know.
Mm-hmm. This is another generic question for you as a private investigator with a lot of experience. Do you get hunches about things? And if so, how does that work for you?
Well, I get immediate hunches. And then that's the difference between the private eyes and the police. Like, the police have inside information. And they have large data banks, and they have a large team of people. With the private investigator, they have to work from the outside in, so they really, really have to rely on that hunch. And the hunch, you go direct to it. It's and then what you do is you work backwards. You discard from that point. You discard what doesn't seem to be the reality of it, but very often the first hunch is really, really good, you know. It's a bit of an instinct. I think it is a little bit of a talent, mm-hmm. and it does get better. You get better at it.
I mean, for you, is it when you get a hunch, you have that feeling like, you know, I got a hunch. Is it a whisper, or is it an aha, or kind of a dawning thing, or a logical conclusion?
It's something that sticks out. It absolutely sticks right out, and it's like when you're hungry and you just have to eat that thing that you're thinking about, you have to go direct to where that thing is, and you have to check it out. And it's exciting. That's the most exciting time, because the motivation is very, very high. And that's why whenever I get a new case, and I'm still working on cases, whenever I get a new case, I go immediately, because that's the highest point of motivation. That's just the way I think. I don't know.
I mentioned in the intro about, you know, how Hollywood and television programs really glamorize the life and times of private investigators, private eyes, and gosh, they've been running private eye TV shows since the end of the 50s or mid 50s. It's just a never end. It's like an evergreen kind of a topic. If someone's interested in becoming a private investigator, do they go to school for this, or do they study it on their own? How do they get started?
Well, I did. I went to, it was a company over in Vancouver called Executive Security, and they trained you to be, like, to be a security guard, but I didn't want that, so I asked them if they had anything like investigation, and they said they were just going to do one, and so I joined it, and I took that. But actually, at that time, we had to work under another company for a year or so. And actually, the learning takes place when you're on the job. And the fellow that I worked for at the time, he kept saying, "You have a lot to learn. You have a lot to learn." And he was right, of course, but my cases seemed to be quite successful. And one ended up on the front page of the province, and he said, "You have a lot to learn." And I said, "Well, yeah, but..." Well, he said, "That's the thing. You don't want to be on the front page of the prom."
That's pretty...
I got the idea.
Leanne, we're all out of time. It flies by when you're having a good conversation. Thanks for being with us tonight. It's always a pleasure to have you on. Good to talk to you, too.
Thank you, Scott, and your questions are really excellent.
Well, thank you very much. And good luck with the book and the development of the TV series. Let me know how that pans out for you, all right?
Thank you, Scott. Bye-bye now.
Thanks a lot. Take care. That's our program for this evening. Thanks for being with us. Have a great week, and we'll be back on Friday with more Far Out Radio.
Thank you.